Hello, my name is Dean Kontover, and this is The Current Buzz. Today we have Upton Bell. He was the former manager of the Boston Patriots, now the New England Patriots. It was 1971 to 72, is that right?
71, 72, and by the way, I renamed them the New England Patriots because when I saw on the front of the Boston Globe the BS Patriots when I ran town, I went like, oh my God. Please. So I immediately, after the press conference, went to the board of directors and said, if you have, because they change it from Boston Patriots to Bay State Patriots. And I said, who the hell is going to know Bay State Patriots?
Yeah, exactly.
We're moving to Foxborough.
Right.
Let's call it the New England Patriots because we're going to draw from a 5 or 6 state area.
Right.
So that's how it happened.
Okay. Now, a little history real quick. Burt Bell was the first commissioner after World War II of the NFL. That was your father.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
And how long was he commissioner for?
13 years, 46 to 1959.
And was he owner of the
Founder. He was the founder and owner of the Philadelphia Eagles, but also he sold them and became the equal partner with Art Rooney with the Steelers. Until he became commissioner in 1946. So think about this, the Eagles plus the Steelers, I could own the school, the studio, and the town of Chelmsford if our family continued to own one or the other.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, things have changed in regards to the infancy, more or less, of NFL. In fact, the NFL was born August 20th, 1920, that's the original date they used, but more or less after World War II, that's when it started to get into its heyday. But what I brought you in for is something very important you want to tell the people of Merrimack Valley and Greater Lowell in regards to your papers that go into the University of Massachusetts Lowell. And why are you bringing your papers? And you've met people, you've met Nixon, you've met Donald Trump before he was president. All right, but that's and you probably know better than I do. Met kings and queens throughout your life, and now you're giving your papers to UMass Lowell. And when is the date that it's going to be officially? Do we have a date?
Well, first and foremost, what the collection is. It might be one of the largest collections in the country. It's a combination of over 500 books of authors that I've interviewed over my 40-year career
Wow.
in radio and television.
Wow.
Every one of the books, you'll go online and say, let's say David McCullough, the great novelist, well, the great historian of the life of Truman, many presidents. You'll go on, you'll be able to see his history, how many awards he's won, the books that I interviewed him for. Each book, when people are able to go on the site, which they can today, by the way, you'll be able to read what he and every author of those 500 authors wrote to me in their own handwriting.
Wow.
On the book, on the interview, whatever else it is. Now, attached to each one, where it's possible, will be either a radio or television interview that I did with them over those 40 years.
Wow.
Also, there will be pictures. There will be all sorts of video. For instance, your show here in Chelmsford will be on that website eventually.
Well, thank you.
And there's going to be over 1,000 items for history. For instance, after Kennedy was shot, a month or two later, I was in Dallas to go scout spring practice at SMU. And I went over with the camera and actually got in part of the Texas Book Depository, then went out on the grassy knoll and was able to take pictures, black and white pictures, of the window where he was shot from. That's going to be on the website.
Wow.
Also, the lady in red, the famous picture of the lady in red who claimed, and I interviewed her, and she's in the collection, her book.
Mm-hmm.
That claimed that there were other people shooting from that grassy knoll.
Right. I remember that initially.
You'll see her picture on there, and what she wrote to me on the picture and her book.
Wow.
So it is history. But the reason that I picked here, I could have gone to Harvard. Originally, this collection was at the Boston Public Library. I took it out because I wanted a larger panoply of this whole collection and the world for the last 40 or 50 years. I decided I want to take it to a place like the University of Massachusetts Lowell because I wanted it in a place in a town that was a town of immigrants, a school where you had to work your fanny off to get in there and then pay your own way and struggle through. Brilliant, brilliant students there.
Mm-hmm.
I just felt I wanted it where I thought America was. And I think that America is in the Lowell Chelmsford era where people struggle, but they're the real
have
people.
Struggled. Or yeah. Their families
well,
have struggled.
Well, yeah. No, I know. I've seen your house. It's now a mansion.
It's but, not true.
Yeah, it's not true.
Yeah.
But the whole idea is this is America. This is where it is. And this isn't some student that has the money to get into Harvard
mm-hmm.
or Yale. This and this collection is about America, and I wanted it here.
Wow, thank you. You also came out with a book. If you want to know anything about early football or NFL, if you're a student of football, before gambling, and we'll talk about gambling in football, what you think of it. I don't know if you can see it. Can you read that for me? Oh, by the way, in regards to Upton Bell, I remember hearing that name. I said, I've never known anybody named Upton. How the hell do you get that name? I read it in the book, and now I know.
Well, first of all, the book, this is did so well, it's out in paperback now. And I reckon,
this is paperback.
Yeah, that's, and what I recommend to people, the interesting thing is nationally, Amazon and other people have done surveys. There are more women that have read this book than men. And the reason is, it's not only a story about the NFL, and it comes all the way to today, full circle, but it's a story of my mother, how I got my first name, Frances Upton, who was a Ziegfeld Follies star who was discovered as a teenager working behind the perfume counter at Macy's in New York.
There's still hope.
There is still hope for all of us. And her life, her father was the chief of detectives, Frank Upton, of New York City, spoke six languages, never
wow.
finished high school,
wow.
and was hired because he, at the time, the turn of the century, they would dress him up in disguise and he could go into the Italian section, German section, you know, different areas,
right.
and speak the language. His father, by the way, who was in the collection, William Clary Upton, was part of a group that tried to blow up a police station in Ireland and was thrown out of Ireland. He was part of a group, the Fenians.
Yeah, I'm aware of the Fenians.
Yeah, that objected to British rule.
Mm-hmm.
Came to New York, had 11 children.
Wow.
Wrote a book today you can still get on Amazon, which is in the collection, Uncle Pat's Cabin, which was the story based upon Uncle Tom's Cabin, mm-hmm. Harriet Beecher Stowe's book.
Yeah, right.
Of how the tenant farmers were treated by the British. It was a bestseller. You can still get it today, 120 years later. So there's a whole other story in there besides the football. Then the background of Burt Bell. His father was the Attorney General of Pennsylvania. His brother was the Governor of Pennsylvania and the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court.
Wow.
Their side of the family goes all the way back to Lincoln's sub-cabinet. So this whole history in there. And my mother ended up being the roommate of Ruth Etting from the famous movie Love Me or Leave Me, who was engaged to Mo the Gimp Snyder. And it tells the story of they both had to sleep with guns under their pillows for fear that he would get upset and come in and blow one of them away. She knew Capone. She knew Lindbergh. All of this history is in there.
Wow.
And again, that's the reason I have present at the creation.
If you want to get your wife a Valentine's Day present, a birthday present, a Christmas present, get this book for her so she can read it.
And then
she'll tell you more about football than you know.
Well, it's also about America.
Yeah, it is.
And how things really change. And
right.
Of course, just let Dean know. I'll come down here. I'll sign the book. I'll do whatever you want to do. You'll enjoy it, believe me.
We'll have we have some videos also about when you were a scout in the South, scouted football. And we're going to put them on in the second show. So, but what I want to do is I want to talk about, you know, how you got involved in football. And I want to talk about the game, the 1968 Giants Colts football that propelled the NFL on TV,
right.
The black and white footage of the game. You were there by chance, if I remember.
Well,
the
by
book.
Chance, I saw the three most important games in NFL history. The 1948 game, when my father was commissioner in a blinding snowstorm in Philadelphia, the first nationally televised game.
Okay.
1958, Burt Bell, my father, put in the rule about sudden death that nobody had thought of. I was at that game. 1968, which is two chapters in the book, I was the personnel director of the Baltimore Colts when we lost to the famous high guarantee game to Joe Namath. So all of those were there. But the 58 game is really interesting. The first year my father...
Did I say 58 game? I'm sorry. I think I said 68 game.
Well, look, they all were historic.
Yeah.
The 58 game, my father had put a rule in. He said to the owners, in those days, the All-Star game in Chicago was a big, big draw for the NFL.
Right.
The champion played the best players.
Soldiers Field, was it?
Soldiers Field.
I remember.
Near 100,000 people. It was bigger than life. It was like the Super Bowl today. And basically, he said, well, what happens if a game ends up in a tie? What are we going to do, flip a coin and look ridiculous and say, well, the team that won flipped the coin, even though it was a tie, is going to play the All-Star game. So he said, I'm going to put in a rule. It will be called sudden death. And we will go to another overtime if the game is tied at the end of the game. And the first team to score by either field goal or a touchdown wins the game.
Right.
Nobody ever figured it ever happened.
Mm-hmm.
1958, historic year. People who live around here, before the Patriots really became famous, this was Giant territory.
That's right, it was. Because they would get the Giant feed
every week.
New York every week.
So the Giants are amazing at the end of the year. They played the Browns twice. They beat them in New York in a blinding snowstorm when Pat Summerall, who later did CBS and then with John Madden on Fox, kicked the winning field goal with seconds left in a blinding snowstorm. I think it was 48 yards. That threw it in to a tie between the Giants and the Browns. So they had a playoff game, and the Giants won 10-0. The Giants were heavily favored over the Colts. So my father, every year we went everywhere, mm-hmm. his kids with him.
Mm-hmm.
He called me, I was in Philly, and he was already in New York, and he said, Upton, are you coming to the game? He said, you can get a train up and I'll take care of everything. I said, well, is Joe DiMaggio and Marilyn Monroe going to be there?
Talk about
this is a teenager, right?
Yeah.
And
so, about the past.
So he said, I don't know about Marilyn Monroe, but I think DiMaggio is going to be there. That's the only reason I went. Because I'd gone to all the other games. Mm-hmm. I said, what the hell? I can see it on television.
Right.
It was an amazing thing. I did meet DiMaggio in the stadium club before the game. And I had met him once before, but I wanted to talk to him.
Right.
And
about
I
the
said,
great Yankees.
Yeah, and that's a whole other...
Another show
about who Joe DiMaggio really was.
Okay.
So I end up sitting on the 50-yard line. I had binoculars, could see right down on the field. And it appeared that the Colts were going to run away with it, 14-3. And then the Giants came back. And then, of course, we had the two-minute drive, which changed pro football forever. Still the greatest quarterback I've ever seen. It's in my book. Unitas and Brady. I'm just about tied.
But just about tied? Now, according to your book, you put Johnny Unitas as number one.
Well, I did. But I said I would take either one.
Oh, okay. All right.
But the thing is that two-minute drive and what it did for professional football, 50, 60 million people around the country were absolutely you know, bananas over this whole ending because they never heard of it before. But if you looked at that drive to tie the game and then the drive to win it, it's still the most amazing drive I've ever seen. Remember, unlike today, no beautiful manicured fields. It was Yankee Stadium. The Yankees played there early in the year.
So there was you're dusty. Telling me there was ruts.
Ruts, dusty, dirty.
Muddy.
Muddy. It's the way football should really be.
Yeah, I agree.
Too nice now. And to watch that is amazing. And then I always tell people, and I think I said it in the book, I'm a great believer. And when you do the job, whatever, whether it was interviewing or whether it's whatever your job is, do the job, walk away, no histrionics, no kissing, no hugging. Every play you think it's orgasm. I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous. As you see Unitas hand the ball off to Amici, Amici goes in the end zone. People are going crazy. I can't tell you what it was like at the stadium, running on the field.
Oh, yeah, in those days, and knocking down the goalposts.
Oh, yeah, they kill you. Unitas hands the ball off, and like somebody like the great Will Kane out of High Noon, you know, kills the bad guys and walks away, turns his back, puts his hands on his hips, and walks off the field. One of the great, if you were doing a show and you could have a ending like that, people never forget it. It's one of the great scenes. Mm-hmm. And many books now have been written about it. And one of the books.
The cover on it? Was there a cover of him doing that when he was walking off?
No.
Do I remember something like that?
Well, it's all on tape. You can get that because there's stories down on my father.
Everything's on tape these days.
Everything. Too much.
Yeah. Reading your book, I found very interesting is you were scouting in the South. And it was very interesting because the South was different than it is today. At least I think it is.
Not that much.
You don't think so? All right. So tell me the story about going down South, because you went to a lot of African-American colleges looking for talent for Baltimore. In those days, it was just in its infancy, having African-American players coming into the NFL, just like Jackie Robinson was to the Brooklyn Dodgers. And I want you to go through the things that you experienced in the South. And people are going to see it on the video even more so.
Yeah.
When we show the video. So.
Well, Dean, it really changed my life.
How old were you then?
24.
And what were you driving?
I was driving. What did I know? Because in those days, they give you a car and about 50 brochures and say, it's January, don't come back to June. So what I did is I went out and rented a huge Lincoln Continental.
So you could sleep in the back?
Could be. And as I describe in the video, which people will see later on, you know, some people described it as Moby Dick. You know, you're driving around the South in these small towns in there.
Yeah.
But to go back and give you some perspective and your audience, is that one of the things that people don't know, you mentioned Jackie Robinson, the greatest backfield, you go on YouTube and get this, of its time, was Kenny Washington and Jackie Robinson, running backs at UCLA, back in the 40s.
That's right, before the war.
Before the war. You can go on YouTube and get it today. If you saw Jackie Robinson and Kenny Washington, you would say Jackie Robinson was the better of the two players. If the color line had been broken at that time in the NFL, nobody knows why they even had it, if they did have it, because there were African-American players that did play preceding that.
Right.
Jackie Robinson, if I was the scout then, I would have drafted Jackie Robinson as a football player.
I didn't realize how important scouting was till I read your book.
Oh, it's the whole ball game.
Yeah.
It's why the Patriots are not in the Super Bowl. It's because they didn't draft well as far as receivers are concerned. And for the last 2 years, everybody's bitching about Brady. The biggest problem is Brady didn't have enough around him this time for them to be there.
And that's why he was a little pissy about it.
Oh, he's never, He's always pissy.
Okay.
But so back to live action.
Yeah.
And scouting. Scouting is the lifeblood of any organization. Belichick.
Quarterbacks?
Well, particularly quarterbacks.
Right.
But the Belichicks, the Shulas, the Andy Reids now, the people who are in the Super Bowl, if they don't get the players, they're not great coaches. How did I learn that? In 1950, I went to the training camp when the leagues merged of the Cleveland Browns. And to me, as I say in my book, Paul Brown is the godfather of all coaches. Even all these years
later. Even the head of Bill Belichick.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, that's right. He does give him credit. You mentioned that he quotes Paul Brown as being the man.
Yeah. Here's Paul Brown. Here's Belichick.
Wow.
Here's Shula. All right, here's a. And the reason is this. Paul Brown was the first person to bring IQ tests into the game. A different type of training, actual playbooks, scouting, studying the different teams on film, bringing the teams.
When did that take effect? Because you must
have. 1948,
49. Oh, okay. So you would take films. When you were traveling in the South, you would take
sure.
Video.
We call it video. It was almost a science by the time I got into it. The computers came in a little bit later on into it. But when I went to the Bears the Browns training camp in 1950, remember they had the first great African American players.
Right.
Marion Motley was before Jimmy Brown, who's the greatest player I've ever seen, bar none. And I saw all of these really good African American players, some of them in the Hall of Fame. But I saw the way, the discipline, all of the things that he brought in the game. And it totally changed everything. And they were due 3 weeks later to play the champion Philadelphia Eagles of the NFL in the game. I remember saying to my father and telling friends, I said, I don't want to be quoted in any newspaper. I said, the Browns will beat the hell out of the Eagles. They said, are you kidding? They're the old All-America Conference. I said, I saw. Now remember, when they came in, I was just 13 years old. But, you know, I've been hanging around clubhouses my whole life. Yeah, the hell? I think I knew what I was talking about. Nobody else did, probably. Yeah. But then they played in Philly, the opening game, and the Browns beat the champion Eagles 31-10.
Wow. Good memory, Upton. Good memory. All right.
So what I'm getting to is I saw how important scouting was. And then I came to the Colts in 1960. My senior year in college, and then went back in 61. And look at how it had changed. Lenny Moore, Hall of Fame, African-American. Jim Parker, Hall of Fame.
I want to hear your experiences in the South.
Oh, my. Okay, I'm going to get to that. Right. But what I started to think when my first trip out in 63 and 64 was, in my mind, the coming was going to be in pro football the African-American player. Those days, they called them the black player.
Mm-hmm.
So my first foray into the South was, and you drove the whole country. You'd leave and drive all the way through the South and then through the Southeast, then the Southwest, and then all the way.
So you saw the signs.
I saw them all. So the thing that I made the comparisons were, I go to the University of Alabama, Bear Bryant was there, Mississippi with Johnny Vaught, Tennessee. The Volunteers, but then I would go to Grambling and
great
Southern
school.
U, Alcorn A&M, and all of the African American schools. And I said, wait a minute, these guys are better than the people I'm seeing at Alabama. but they were practicing, and they were living on dusty, dirty old fields in schools. Much out of the mainstream,
right?
The only one was Tennessee A&I, which was in the same town as Vanderbilt, but most of the other ones, Prairie View, out in the middle of nowhere, Alcorn, out in the middle. Jackson State was not far from Jackson,
right.
Mississippi.
Right.
But when I saw these players, I said, why are they going in the fourth, fifth, sixth round? When they should be going in the first round. And of course, in those days, they were marked down because they weren't in the eyes of the coaches and the teams playing.
And the schools.
Yeah, and the school. The major
perception of the school.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's not, yeah. It was, well, they're not playing Ohio State.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, yeah, but the players are better. So as I was going through, as I talk about, and one of the things that your audience will see is the first time I arrived, it was either Alabama or Mississippi. I remember walking into a luncheonette. Now remember, all of these are small towns,
right,
kind of
right,
strung together.
Yeah.
And I said...
not on the beaten path.
Yeah. And so, you know, the breakfast is in the South. They're still the best I've ever had in America. Yeah, I mean, you got grits. I got the grits. I got everything.
I can tell you a story about how many grits, but I'm not going to tell you because it'll take my time.
It was. Yeah. So I remember going in and sitting down, and first of all, the person looks outside, and he said, hey, what do you do? Are you a traveling salesman, man? And I said, no. I said, I'm a scout for the Colts. Well, at the age of 24, I look like I was not quite out of high school. And so I said, I'm a scout with the Baltimore Colts. The guy looked at me and laughed. He said, well, what the hell is that thing out there, that big boat? I said, well, I have to have a big car to travel.
Yeah. Look impressive. Yeah.
So then he said, well, welcome to, I think it was Mississippi. He said, welcome to Mississippi. He said, it's only been 5 years since we hung the last person. And
you mean you lynched the last person?
Well, I'm using.
You're using, yeah.
Yeah, I'm trying to be kind.
Yeah.
And that really hit me.
That does hit a person.
Yeah. Well, especially somebody who had been around a lot of African American players, but not in a different circumstance. Mm. And as I said, from there on in, you know, you have to be careful because you go into a town. And you say the wrong thing, and they suspect. And a lot of towns I went into, they thought that I was a freedom rider that had come down to register African Americans because I looked so young.
Oh.
And you know, an average scout in the NFL.
That's
in
a whole
day,
book in itself.
Well, I'm going to do a second book you're ready to take it down.
Oh, I'm. Right? I will. I mean, we'll go to Montgomery. Okay.
Well, I've been to all.
I know you have.
So. I thought this could be pretty dangerous because a lot of places, and the police would stop you. I mean, remember, there was gunfire. I said in one of the things that we'll show later on, I said, apartheid is here.
Wow.
This is two Americas, a white America and a black America.
Wow.
And it is stark. And the beauty of the South juxtapose against this bitterness. And I've said, too, if you think America today is divided with what's going on, whatever your mm-hmm. politics are, mm-hmm. ain't nothing compared to what I saw.
Did you ever see the Ku Klux Klan?
No, but I suspected, particularly the police were stopping me at night, were part of the Klan. You know, you get to, after a while, begin to understand. And for instance, if you go into a place and they suspect that maybe you're lying and you can't prove you work for the Colts, as I point out, I could have been face down the Chattahoochee River. I mean, that's the way it is.
And I want
to make it very clear that I am in no way here today indicting whites, blacks, anybody. I'm trying to tell the story as I've told partially mm-hmm. in the book, but. In looking at that, you go into a place and you see if people might remember back to the 19 last.
Well, you have less than a minute, so you've got to.
It's a championship game. If you went in to these places, you'd have to go down like the Natchez Trace and avoid gunfire. And then you get there and you see these players and say, my God, I've never seen anything this good. They should be going earlier. So, again, there's so many stories, but that changed. That changed my life forever in the way that I look at race.
Very good. Fernandin, I appreciate you coming on the show.